Well, happy Monday to all, and we are here for The Bronze Age, Episode 11. That music just leaves me all ready to analyze some replays. Joining me, my good buddy Mitchell. Happy Monday, Mitchell. How you doing?
I'm doing pretty well today. How about yourself?
Ah, can't complain. Gonna look at some Heroes replays and go see Star Wars, so sounds like an evening for me.
Oh, that's gonna be a fun night.
Yep, should be fun. So we have a bronze 5, and thanks to Dravy for being patient, because I've been sitting on his replay for a little while I worked through my backlog, and then a silver 5 to look at today. Hey, it's our good buddy Manco. How's it going? Travi, I've actually touched bases with him earlier, and he has already slugged his way up to silver 5. So congrats to him. That's no small feat, up one full tier already. And slugging your way out of bronze can be brutal sometimes. So congrats to him. Keep up the good work. We're going to go ahead and jump right into his replay. He is playing Zul on Blackheart's Bay, and I think this is the first time we've had a chance to do Blackheart, so we can talk about some of the special things to keep in mind when doing this map, because it's a little bit different from a lot of the other maps in the game.
Yeah, this is... Everybody hates this map, and I can totally understand why. It's one of those maps that I actually really enjoy, just because the way that I like to look at this game is sometimes it's like a real-time chess with, you know, 10 people all at the same time on the same board with their own set of pieces. But this is one of those maps where it's super multifaceted. There's a lot of things to be doing at any given point. There's a lot of things to pay attention to. And if you're somebody like Azul, what I'd like to see starting out is just an easy rotation top and mid, as you have at least one person helping you out just with lane clear, so that you can get to a nice rotation flow, to just help your team get as much XP as possible.
Yeah. This is my third least favorite map. So it's not one of my favorites, but it does have some special considerations, and you beat me to the punch with Zul specifically. So in draft, first of all, as usual, every time we jump into an older replay, we have to adjust the sound way down. That's a byproduct of going into an older replay. And welcome, Andres. We have our Falstad player from Game 2 is here. So let's talk about this map real quick. First of all, in draft, in an ideal world, you want to have a dedicated jungler, somebody who is just going to go around and grab merc camps for you. On this map, the reason it's more important than others is because they serve two purposes. You get coins and the mercs themselves. So mercs are probably more important on this map than any other. Speaking of the boss, this is the weakest boss in any of the bosses in the game, because that top lane has such a long travel distance. You can really hammer it down before it goes anywhere. So boss less important on this map. And let's talk about Zul specifically, because our boy Travi is going to be on Zul. I think a common misconception with lower tier players is that Zul is a solo laner. While Zul can solo lane, that's not his greatest strength. He is an okay solo laner. His greatest strength is the speed at which he clears lanes, which allows him one of the few heroes that can cover multiple lanes single-handedly. And in order for that to happen, the lanes need to be close together, just like the lanes are top and mid. Zul can single-handedly soak both of these lanes safely and allow his team to do other things. So that's really what we want to see, is Travi covering both of these lanes by himself and allowing his teammates to do other things. In solo hero league, your teammate doesn't always take advantage of that, but in a perfect world, that's what we want to see, is Zul covering those top two lanes.
That's something where communication comes in really, really handy. It's something where if I'm the first couple pick on this map and I get to Azul or I get to an Illidan to jungle, I'm letting my team know essentially what I'm going to be doing from the get-go. So as soon as I locked in that hero, I'm saying, okay, in this case, I'd probably be Auriel. Stick with me. We're going to rotate top and mid, and try to put that out there so that the team understands what I'm going for. Good old Esports here, right?
Yep. The useless skirmish.
five of you are up here.
Yep. So here's the first thing to note, yeah, and while we are going to focus,
we'll talk about that.
Yeah, while we are going to focus on Travi specifically, as always when you do this, we are going to point out things other players do because you can learn from everybody in a game. Even if you play a perfect game, you can still learn from the other nine players in the game. So blue team's first mistake is they're missing all the soak bottom and giving Asmo free. I mean, look at the tower already. This is 30 seconds into the game, and he's got one tower down 30% health and almost half ammo, and that's simply because nobody else is down here. So the idea, now I'm going to say it again, I understand in Hero League you can't always do this because not everybody is going to be on the same page, but in a perfect world, once this game gets going, Greymane is the designated jungler. He can solo all of the camps, but the boss, he'll just lose some life in the process. So as long as he recharges in between, he can handle all of the solo lane, all of the solo camps just fine. Zul can take Ariel, or maybe Stitches, or neither, and bounce between these two lanes, and that allows everybody else to put pressure on bottom. And that puts a lot of pressure on the other team.
One of the things that you learn, and maybe Travis learned this already since he's moved up a little bit, is knowing when to respond to things. This is something that even we struggle with our ranks. And first of all, know what you have to respond to, right? If there's even the threat of somebody like an Asmodan, who's an excellent solo laner, you have to pay attention to that. What everybody's doing right here, and see, Trapping might actually have the right idea here. He cleared, and he's already on his way either mid or bot, we don't know yet.
Or to the chest, which is where he should be going.
Right. But he's absolutely got the right idea. I mean, he got what he needed to do up there at top, and so now he needs to just move on. Can you hover his...
I was just checking it. Okay, Shackler. Let's talk about that.
Yeah.
You and I are both Master Skin Zools, and we both play him a fair amount. How many times have you ever taken Shackler?
Twice.
And
0% win rate.
Yeah. Shackler is kind of a trap talent. Both of them, both Shade and Backlash, are better individually. We don't really talk about talents too much. There's a reason for that. We really want to focus on the decision-making within the game. However, looking at their team, a big fat Asmo with a huge health pool and a Nubarak, both of which
his health just got punished, by the way.
Yes, it did. Both of which would be punished by Backlash, or Shade would be helpful against Lenora. And also, people still don't take Backlash into account. It's a massive bomb when you hit it.
It is 15%
it's huge.
Target's maximum.
And nobody takes it into account. And I'll drop it on tanks all the time because it's just a massive chunk of health that they're not really expecting to lose out of nowhere. So focus on, I would have gone Backlash here for that reason.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and Shade wouldn't have been bad versus Lunara, but I think Backlash is the pick. You just don't get enough value out of Shackler.
And that's part of the problem too, especially with a comp like this. I would imagine the thought process was get the slow for the KT and for the Greymane to be able to keep up. You don't need it in
this case.
You've got a root.
A hook.
KT's got a stun, and we've got a hook on our team. So the thing is, once you get the Wombo, you're going to get a kill. That Shackler is actually not going to come into account pretty much at all. And maybe it was an anti-Lunara pick at the same time, but still... Somebody like Lunara, once her frontline is done, which you can do a lot easier with Backlash, once her frontline is done, she is ineffective.
The only time I would ever remotely consider Shackler is maybe if you were kind of trying to coordinate an Executioner-style team, maybe, I guess. But beyond that, I just don't see a situation in which I would take it.
Yeah, it's just that the other ones are so
good. Yeah. And right here, Backlash on this Anubarak.
Would have killed.
Yeah, and then granted, our boy's up here. By the way, you know, Travi, we've been talking a lot. We haven't been on you as much as I would like. He's got the right idea, other than he wasn't here for the coins, but his team cleaned them up anyway, so no big deal. He is absolutely right. Rotating, and you can already see why he went from Bronze 5 to Silver 5 already.
Yeah, I mean, he's got that rhythm down, and that's part of what makes Zul effective on this map. If anything, in terms of just personal decision-making, start to ping bottom. Start to let your team know that there's nobody down there, that they
yep.
can see somebody down there. Of course, they're moving down there already, but because you were in the situation where you're just sticking to the rotation, just go for it. Just go ahead and ping.
Say missing bot. I will try to steal these doubloon camps if you have vision, especially when you know the enemy is so heavily invested in the bottom lane. So don't be afraid to try to snipe those in between rotations here. But Travi, great job of this two-man rotation. Between you and KT, you can own these top two lanes all game long. And I would consider the mana talent at level 4. If you're going to be doing this a lot, you're burning through a lot of mana. Zul can definitely be a mana hog if you use his talents on a cooldown.
Yeah, and I mean, that is the most effective way to do it, and that's why I would consider him. I haven't played Rag yet, but I'm pretty positive that Zul is the best wave clearer in the game, in terms of just his abilities being able to clear a lane.
Well, and it's twofold. It's not just how fast he clears lanes, which he does. You're eating tower shots back up there. It's not how fast he clears lanes, too, which he does, but it's that he adds to the wave when he clears it, too. It's a double thing.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, the mana talent at 4, I've just turned Brian onto this. He was one of those people that doesn't like to take it, which is fine. Jailers can be really good.
It's just map dependent.
Healing talent at W at 7, but I love Trickle's Essence. There's not a game where I don't take it. Those are always my 4 and 7 are the sustain talents, and then you can take whatever you want to. Right here, you chose the extra distance on your Q,
yeah.
I think it was, which is okay. Maybe it helps you get a couple of those picks back in the background.
I don't think I ever take it.
It's sustain. Sustain, sustain, sustain. When you've got a semi-gank squad in the Anubarak, in the Li Ming, in the Lunara, sustain, sustain, sustain.
Now,
you never have to go back. You never have to tap. Just get globes, kill minions, and you are always at top mana and top health.
Now, I'm going to say, Travi, you are doing 110% exactly what you should be doing, and your team's level lead is entirely because you are doing exactly what you should be doing while everybody else on both teams is kind of farting around. Red team hasn't manned lanes this whole game. Your team's been wandering around and sort of murking, and Travi has been 100% diligently in these top lanes with nobody else, and look at what he's done. He's almost got a fort here. He's got into fort damage here. Both walls are down, and that is 100% Travi. This is why you're already in silver, because you're doing this while none of your other bronze competitors are.
Yeah, this is something I want to watch for the rest of the game as well, because this is a trap I got to when I wasn't as skilled with Zul. By the way, Travi, stay clear that lane when it pushes out from the tower like that. You just walked away from XP. Again, Zul's fast. It probably doesn't matter. You'll probably be back up there in time. But just clear it. That way you have it.
Because there was about a half a wave missed there. About a half wave.
Yeah.
Not a big deal. Yeah, not a big deal.
Not at all. It's not going to make the difference between anything.
Now, though... What I do want to see you adjust is, now that your team has turn in, when they start posturing to turn in, I would like to see you go down there so your team doesn't lose all those coins, because nothing is going to be more painful than your team dropping 10 coins and undoing all of the work you just did. See, now, I mean, your team right here is fighting a 3-on-3, so that's not terrible. And actually, they're winning it. You can look at the health bars. But if Li Ming came down here, which she might be, and Lunara, that's both of their damage dealers, that team fight could be very different. So we really want to watch our mini-maps and find out when your presence is going to be needed to turn in those coins.
That's something that's really hard to do.
It is. It really is.
I mean, it's one of those things I messed up on a lot of the times when I was fairly new to this game, was just concentrating on what my character could do and just doing that to the best of his ability. I mean, the thing is here, like... I would probably be doing the same thing.
Because they're literally not responding to it. I was just going to say, we're going to flip the script here a little bit, and we're going to analyze Red Team's decision-making. They are playing very foolishly by allowing him to completely dominate two lanes without turning in, and then allowed a free objective.
He's doing what most Asmo players do.
Absolutely.
Just
absolutely.
Hanging out by himself all game and getting a ton of work done.
And look, two forts down through the first turn-in, and they still have more than half the cannonballs left. By the way, Backlash would have killed Lele here.
Boom, pop.
There was your Backlash kill right there. Don't chase into the towers, though. Don't chase into the towers. Back up. See, now you're probably in trouble.
This is the perfect, the perfect opportunity for Dracula's Essence and for Wrathma's Blessing at 4 and 7, yep, respectively. You wouldn't be in this position where you're about to get killed by a Anubarak.
Greymane might come save you, yeah, but the level 4 and 7, the mana and health, when basically you've decided you're pushing the whole game, those are the things that allow you to push pretty much indefinitely. And if you're planning on pushing Azul, you need to take him at 4 and 7.
Yeah. I mean, I think by that time we've already had made the decision and had seen that Red Team is going to mostly leave us alone. And so that's what you have to start thinking about. I just had this conversation with one of my friends last night. You know, maybe those are just comfort picks for him. Maybe he doesn't like to take anything else. One of the keys to getting better at this game is understanding the talent system.
And when to pick which talents.
Because I love the Drain Hope build on Leoric. But if I'm ever on Braxis, I'm now taking Hardened Bones and Lingering Apparition at 4 and 7 respectively, because that allows me to play objective a lot better than I could if I just take it the Drain Hope talent.
Unless there's a Cho'Gall or a Diablo on the other team. And that goes back, right, to understanding the talents and why they're effective in certain situations.
So
I like this response, Travi. You should be coming here. If ever the enemy is willing to take a 10 to non-10 engagement, you have to take it. But it doesn't matter if they're outnumbered. So this is a good response for Zul to come down here right away. I'm going to backtrack a little bit. 100% the reason this death happened is because you tower dove after the Lili. So that's just something to be aware of. Know when you're going to get the kill and when you're not. Once Lili got away with fast feet, you are not going to kill her. And all of the rest of blue team needs to be down here. I'm not sure where they're at. See, this is a poor decision by KT. He came in and started channeling a turn in instead of mopping up all these people. This is a really poor Phoenix. And there the bank of Greymane just exploded.
If that Phoenix is right above that shark, are you kidding me? That all three of those people would be dead.
Right, or a living bomb down here. I mean, KT could and should make the difference. So, Travi, you're really, other than the little tower diving there, that was a little bit foolish. Other than that, he's been pretty spot on. It's been really the teammate of other players to focus on. But now, look, Anubarak is going to go steal all these coins and dive away. And that's what I said earlier. Make sure you're with your teammates when you should have been here. And you were. This was more on KT and your teammates from before.
And I'll give you another hint right
here. Oh, Anubarak's not leaving! What a silly Anubarak!
In terms of things I've learned as Zul, when you're ahead, take poison.
Yeah.
Skeletal Mages is amazing against the Lili fast feet and against
Especially in bronze too. They're not gonna look for the poison nova.
But backlash plus poison nova
is so much damage.
Can be upwards of 2,000 damage, yep, on a single target if you get it right.
I know you and I have both melted an entire front line with those talents, especially up in level.
And that's the key there. When I'm behind is when I take skeletal mages.
I'm gonna go back just a little bit here, because there's something I want to talk about here in this.
Skeletal mages kind of allows you to turn a fight a lot better, whereas in this case you're already ahead. You want to keep your lead, so you want that burst.
So Travi makes two errors right here. Error number one is Stitches is turning in already, and Stitches has enough by himself to get the turn in.
See this all the time.
Yeah. So Travi, your turn in is completely unnecessary. Number two, once you realize, I know you can't see Leeming right now on the vision, but when you can, when she gets right here, you keep trying to channel. At that point, you know you're not going to get it. Get off. So many people don't seem to realize you can simply get off the channel and start attacking them. I can't tell you how many free kills I've gotten by just getting off early and hitting somebody with something. So
yeah, I mean, the thing about it is you're not locked in.
Just click away.
Just click away.
But what I really want to see is I want to see you out here zoning for Stitches, dismounting Leeming, disrupting them, throwing down a bone prism, and allowing Stitches to turn in, because your turn in is not needed at all. See, now, right here, you need to be off. Because you should be... Greymane's coming in. You guys will have an advantageous fight here, but watch how much free damage he takes by just standing here.
Look at that!
That's like 50% of your health bar and free damage that you just took by standing there and eating the skill shots.
If you go further with that, and if you say, Travi, stand in the... stand right there where you're standing right now, right in the corner of the tippy top of that shroud that's right there. And you would have had vision on the Limi and the Lunara as they come in to dismount them. Now, of course, this doesn't end up being a problem.
No, not at all.
For this team, because they're already ahead, and Red Team, of course, decided to fight. And they didn't have 10 again for however many times that's been this game. But it's just one of those things. Were you not in that position? Were things not exactly the same? I mean, this is a real
time strategy game. If Red Team had ultimates.
Ifs and buts are everything in this game. And you have to. Part of being a better player is actually anticipating and reacting to the ifs and buts and trying to prepare yourself for those.
Well, and developing good habits.
It's part of what will make you a better player. It will make you more valuable to your team. So it's just something to think about.
Zul is not a good solo merc camper. He can do it. It takes him too long. It's not ideal. With Ariel here, not
he
as big of a deal.
He started it when Ariel was right there. I don't think that he was worried about Ariel not coming to help him.
But just make sure you've got help when you do it, because it's not his biggest strength, and it means you're not doing other things. But so far, Travi has not really made any poor decisions. The build is not optimized. But his decision-making gameplay in-game has been largely good, and I'm not surprised he's not in Bronze 5 anymore. All of these red team players, I am not surprised they are in Bronze 5.
Yeah, I'm not surprised Travi's not in
Nor am I. Heroes 101, do not take a fight when they're 10 and you're not. There's just no situation ever where it's worth it. Ever.
The red team
destroyed a fort. I'm curious to see what they do right after this.
Me too.
They're all paid up.
Now, you guys don't have vision. Once again, backlash, so much mileage right here.
Okay, hold on. Let's take a look at this 1 second. Okay. We talk about the concept of value in this game all the time. We talk about the concept of understanding what you're doing in a game and how that affects the rest of your team. This is something I see Zuls do freaking all the time. It's something I see just countless number of characters do this all the time. And that's just doing something just to do it.
Right.
Right here, you popped up on a Nubarak.
At full health.
Full health. Almost full mana. 98% mana. He's got a lot of tools of escape. He's got an unstoppable. First of all, unless you've seen the characters Unstoppable go out, we're talking about the Johannas, we're talking about the Anubaraks, we're talking about the Leorics. Do not ever Bone Prison them.
Right, it's a waste.
You will get the fury of your team. If I'm ever playing with you, I will not stop talking about it, because it's just a waste of time, it's a waste of mana, it's a waste of... It's all of these resources, right, that you just wasted just because you wanted to do it. If you had waited for the Anubarak to burrow away after that Greymane who's right behind you initiates, perfect time for a Bone Prison.
Absolutely.
Pick and choose. Like we've said so far, you've been mostly fine, and this is such a nitpicky thing. This is not something that's not really important to
this
game particularly. It's just important to
generally
overall getting better, thinking about the game in a different way, that kind of stuff. You didn't need to throw the Bone Prison out.
We both also piggyback on what Kyle Ferguson says a lot with body language and Hero League and reading what you're doing. Zul is one of the great projection characters. Is the Bone Prism specifically makes it really easy for your team to understand what you're trying to do. Just like Lili's Cups, we talk about that when we have a Lili player. So when you're playing Zul in a solo environment, what you need to look at that Bone Prism as is a giant bullseye for your team. And it even gives them a lead up. This is the person we're all going to attack. And a lot of teams will really follow up on that. So you're not gonna get a Nubarak here. I think the ideal way to do this was you need to wait back a little bit. Let the whip come out. She can maybe whip it into the tower range here. Let Greymane go into wolf form and scare him, and maybe he burrows away, and then you catch him with the Bone Prism after. But Bone Prisming, like a Johanna, unless they just pop Direskin, all those heroes you talked about, Samuro, who has his ulti up, it's just kind of a wasted talent. Not that big a deal because nothing's going to come of it. But if you're more selective with that Bone Prism, think of it as a giant bullseye for your team. This is who we're going to kill, which means you're not going to throw it on tanks very much, by the way, unless you have Backlash. You really, really want to save it for those heroes that you want to blow up.
Yeah, you touched on the Backlash point.
And there it is. That's why right there.
And you know what?
Now, by the way,
if
you still had the Bone Prism, Lunara's dead. She is 110% dead. She might be dead anyway, but she would definitely be dead if you stole the Bone Prism.
But the thing is, there's how many more resources do you now waste? There goes an ulti, by the way.
And the reason Anubarak's going to die here is not because of anything you guys did, it's because of what he didn't do, which is simply walk away.
Okay. KT's the only one that's been responding to Asgore.
Which is fine, because he has the wave clear to do it.
It's been okay, and it hasn't hurt them so far.
Right. But you know, so far, Travi has done kind of the typical thing to do. He soaked before 10, and now he's staying with his team. In general, that's a good strategy to have. Soak before 10, then get with your team. I'm not sure why the healer wasn't there or whatever, but...
No, that was the Great Mate's fault.
Yeah, but you can throw in a little whoosh to maybe get him out alive. Or, the friendly Stitches hook. That's what I want to see there.
He used his engage, or his disengage forward, for whatever reason. It was probably invisible.
But a nice friendly Stitches hook there would have got him out hunky-dory. There's a great Bone Prism, by the way. That's the good Bone Prism right there. On the Lunara. Now, why your team didn't turn around on the Lunara and they still pursued the Anubarak is beyond me, but that was a good Bone Prism.
Stop hitting the tank, guys.
Good hook. Body block, body block. There we go. Well done.
The only reason you guys got that kill was because of the hook.
Yep, that was a good hook. And I don't know what Lili is doing here either. That's a good Bone Prism. All of this is good. Something we see at Bronze a lot is not knowing when to end. You guys can't end here, obviously, but at level 20, this is an endable scenario. So really keep that in mind when you're starting to get to this point in the game. You're going to start wanting to look at really putting your foot on the throat of the other team.
Can you jump back about 20 seconds before Absolutely. That Anubarak got picked?
Oh, that's probably too far.
Oh yeah, a little bit. I want to see when that split happened.
On the split on the Lunara?
Yeah, when they went to Anubarak, but they should have turned around on Lunara.
Okay, so here's the Gray Mane. What I want here is the friendly Stitches hook, by the way. Stitches players, he can stand right here and just...
He's too out of range.
Yeah, he is, but he wasn't 5 seconds ago.
I feel like we could go back and forth on that all day.
Yeah, I mean, Stitch should have been up here with this team. I mean, he turned in 4, I guess.
It's on Gray Mane, though. Gray Mane should have...
Oh, for sure. For sure, absolutely. It's on Gray Mane. It's on Grayman. But sometimes you can save teammates from themselves. Okay, so here's the split we're talking about. Red's going to have a funky, weird engagement here.
Perfect for blue team.
Leeming, that's just plain silly. Great Bone Prism on... Well, actually, you know what? I'm going to make a minor criticism here. I just noticed it. I just noticed it right now. So earlier, he's specking into this Q, right? So he wants to increase reach on the Q. When our Azul comes right here, alive and well, Leeming walks right by him. Oh no, the poison's already on her. Okay, yeah, the living bomb, she's done. So yeah, that's perfect. Great, nice route on the Lunara, and everybody ignores her.
Okay, so, right? Once those coins are picked up by anybody...
Yep, they went at the right one.
Okay, but just watch what keeps happening, right? They get distracted again by the Leeming.
Well, this is a free kill.
And then Lunara starts to turn in after this kill.
Gets
the turn in for their team.
Yes,
so,
she does.
You guys did an awesome job of killing people.
And picking up all those coins.
Yeah.
And now Lunara's dead. You're going to get more 3 coins off her. Hook! Hook her!
And look, she might actually get out of there.
Wow, she did get out of there. Well played, Lunara. Now, though, this bottom lane needs to be responded to. I want to see this whole blue team go kill Asmodan right here.
You know, they had the Bone Prison on Lunara as well when they decided to chase the Anubarak.
Where is everybody on blue team going? Everybody needs to come kill Asmodan right here. The whole team needs to rotate on him and just wreck him.
Yeah, you're primed picking right there, especially because you guys are so... I think that they're doing it right now.
They are, just kind of in a weird way.
He was... The KT was really low on mana, I believe.
That was a nice job on Greymane there. Good stun, but nice job on Greymane.
That was a good follow-up. The other thing I would have put out there is just to kill that Lunara when you get the chance. Your squishy targets are always, when 100% of the time, everybody can prove me wrong, I don't care. Your squishy targets are always more valuable than hard-to-kill targets.
Yes, absolutely.
A Leeming is always, 100% of the time, going to be more valuable to kill than Johanna. It's just simple mathematics. Who's the damage dealer and who's getting numbers done? Squishy people who do a lot of damage.
Yeah,
not the strong, hard to kill people.
Now, who has their coins? Oh, they're there. Okay, great. Other than that really bizarre situation in which you need to stop a channel or something stupid, when the tank's job is to take damage and you're allowing them to take damage for their teammates, you're allowing them to do their job successfully. That's a dead
Lunara. You're actually putting your own team at a disadvantage, because then your team is wasting resources killing somebody that they probably can't kill in a certain situation. I mean, we talk about value and resources all the time, right? Cooldowns, mana, abilities that you can't use in another 5 seconds when somebody else comes up on you. I mean, it's stuff that you gotta start thinking about. It's the old expression, work smarter, not
better. Oh, this is gonna go really, really badly. Now, this is where I wanna see some map awareness from Travi. You're not gonna 1v1 an Asmo to death. It's not gonna happen. But you can see what's going on behind you here. I wanna see you back over here. If you're gonna participate in this, back over here.
And this is something too, check this out. Why don't you just put the root on Anubarak so you know he's delayed, Asmodan, so you know he's delayed.
And walk over there. You can drop the skeleton mages right in the middle of the team fight, especially because Stitches isn't here. You're the closest thing to a tank they have.
Right.
All the more reason to be up here. So this is waste.
That was going to be my point right there, is that understanding your role in a team, regardless of your role put out there in the game. The game has specific roles for us because it wants things to be easily divisible, because we're humans and we're kind of stupid. But you, as a player, have to understand your role in a specific team.
Like tanking this is your role.
You have to understand your role when other people are dead. You have to understand your role when people are missing. Ariel's
is going to die. Ariel's going to die. I was just going to go over this. We were just talking about this. This is such a good illustration. So the bosses aggro on whoever is closest to them. It's easy. If you're closer to them, they will attack you. So Travi, with no Stitches, and you guys here, your job is to eat this damage. So you need to be in here on this. And Squishies need to be on the safe side. So Kael'thas should be over here. Greymane's fine. He should be up in here meleeing. But this Ariel, the free death, is just silly and not necessary. And now at this point, I don't even know that you guys can take this boss now, to be honest, with no Stitches here.
One of the things that we are starting to learn now, which is fairly obvious to pros, not to anybody else who plays this game, it doesn't matter if it's one or if it's five. If the other team is there, excuse my French, get the hell off the boss.
Get off the boss.
There's no point anymore.
Well, no, and Stitches, I don't know. You guys, this is not going to happen. The boss has leashed and is now at 100% health.
And the other team knows that they're there.
And now KT is going to die to Leeming. Or just let the boss wail on her. Ooh. Oh my goodness.
You know, with the... And Greymane died to minions. With the backlash or with the...
Okay, Stitches needs to come up here and help.
Oh my god. Yeah, that's on Stitches.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. This, you know, Blue has been rocking this whole game because Red simply has been making worse decisions than Blue has. But once again, where are you going? Every move you should have in this game should have a purpose. I don't know what Stitches' purpose is here.
Yeah, one of the things my good friends always says when he plays this game, sometimes he'll say this, he says, I don't know what to do, which is a phrase that should never come out of your mouth if you're playing this game. You should always have something to do, even if it's something as simple as, well, let's just clear lanes, four people are dead, and there's nothing else I can do. There is something you can be doing at all times. This is a real-time strategy game. This is not a turn-based strategy game. This is not.
I'm even going to take that a step further. Sometimes the thing to do is just not die. So doing nothing can actually be doing something in specific situations.
Isn't that amazing how doing nothing, such as not dying, actually ends up doing something, which is not giving value to the other team.
Right.
Not giving XP to the other team. Not letting that other team have that much more of an advantage on your team. In that case, doing nothing is actually doing something.
See, like right here, this is a mistake, Travi.
Yes.
This is a mistake. This is giving value to the other team.
Your job right there was tank. What did tanks do? They absorb damage and they peel for their teammates.
And also, your healer is pinging retreat. This game is really all over the place. But definitely, this is a 3-on-2 now. You need to be realizing and heading the other direction.
Let's back up like 7 to 10 seconds.
There we go. Yes, absolutely.
See, right when they invaded. I'm just curious exactly how that went down.
Okay, so here's getting the camp, and every time there's going to be a fight, this should happen automatically in your head. They're 5, you're 4. Let's see the vision that they have. Okay, here's the vision blue team has. So their vision is they have nobody. We talked about body language. Lunara's body language, she's charging full in 1-on-2. So that tells me she is not 1-on-2. As soon as Lunara came in here, even though it sucks to get rid of the camp, the correct call is to leave.
Lunara's don't usually charge
somebody. Not by themselves. There's got to be somebody behind them.
Here's side 2 of discussion. Because guess what we did? Exactly what we wanted to do, which was get the camp.
Get the camp.
So,
get out.
R2, get the hell out of there.
Get out.
What are you doing?
Get out.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't. You guys are on even tiers. You guys are one. I mean, there's an endless list of reasons of why we could tell you to leave right now.
But number one is they have 5 people alive, and you don't know where they are, and you only have 4 people alive.
Right, and that simple understanding is enough to tell you leave.
Now,
and leave to fight another day.
Right in this moment, Travi is in the correct spot. As long as he goes, and the second Ariel crosses him, he turns back around. Because Travi is the tankiest character here. As soon as Ariel crosses him, he needs to be the last man out just to absorb damage. So right
and
when... Now you're leaving. And that's perfect. The skeletal mages, too. That's a perfect disengage if everybody simply turned and left here.
I'll disagree, and I'll tell you why right now. He went the Q build, which puts a
slow right
on his Q.
You're correct.
So he could have gotten 2 to 3 of those chasers in a simple Q to get them the slow
without using his heroic.
That's the peel right there for your team to GTFO, and that's all you need to do. You could have saved yourself the mana. You could have saved yourself the skeletal mages. And that's probably the Grey Mane's death. You can keep going. That's probably the Grey Mane's death right here. That you could have saved as well. I mean, Ariel understood that all she needed to do was leave.
Yep.
And because the Grey Mane was there, body language, again, we talk about all the time, start to re-engage.
I don't know what he's doing. He's literally just standing there.
Yeah, it just becomes this whole thing where if you two would have left, he probably would have left too. Maybe he was looking at his phone or, you know, who knows what the heck he was doing right there. But, you know, it's just one of those things. You throw your Q out instead of the skeletal mages. You get the slow on 2 of them. They can't chase anymore. And all, if you two leave, Greymane will leave.
Yep. So yeah, I mean, you got out alive, which is great. But that should have been once you guys get the camps, just a hard disengage. And all of this should be disengaging too. This is really poor positioning by the tank. Tanks know your role. Your role is not to do damage. Your job is to be back here and either preventing your team from dying or setting up the other team to die. But you don't actually do the damage more often than not unless you're a Muradin in certain situations. But
that's something I see we have a problem with. Like, people at our level have a problem with tanks chase.
Yes.
Hard.
Yes.
And I hardly understand why.
Now, I guess you're trying to go help Stitches, But once again, it's a 5-on-4, and you're completely split from your team. If red team, these two heroes in particular, simply turns around, you guys are so hosed. I would have really liked to have seen you back up here with Ariel and KT and attempt to clear out this Asmo push safely in defense of the keep.
It's the same part of the conversation.
Yep. Oh, there you go. Perfect, Travi. Nice.
Yeah. He turned around. He got
yeah,
it.
Nice. That's perfect. Yep. And just know, neither one of you guys is going to save stitches here. Yep. So poison... Yeah, KT just stayed and killed himself there. Absolutely, yeah.
KT did not have the right. Unless he gets out.
This is, by the way, as a red team, where it is okay to chase the tank. One of the few.
I mean, yeah, if you're a new Brack, you want to be chasing because you have that built-in unstoppable at the same time.
And because KT literally had zero life left.
Now, okay, let's talk a little bit about counter pressure, if we could. I don't think this is a possible moment or anything like that. However, this is something that we worked to great effectiveness last night after you left us. Okay, you guys took like 2.5 fights that went really, really poorly, right? You gave them a little bit of an advantage. Greymane died first. Stitches started to chase and die afterwards. Let's start to rethink everything that we're doing at this given moment. We see four people down at bottom. I'm Zul. Guess what else I see on the other side of this map?
Two dead keeps. Yep.
And all of and minions. Not only two dead keeps, right? Minions pushed all the way to core. I see part one of what I'm going to say happening right away, which is you guys getting this camp up here. And then the other part of what I was going to say was, first of all, invade, get their camp, and start getting some pressure so that this pressure comes off of you guys.
Now,
pressure is a very specific thing, and maybe it's too advanced for this podcast, and that's okay. But it's one of those things where you have to, at this point, because things have happened that have already happened, you have to now give the other team something to respond to, because all they're thinking is win, 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 win. We just hit 20. We just got our first keep. There's two people dead. Let's freaking go in there and let's win. Guess what happens, right? You and Ariel start to push. Maybe you guys don't even get a camp. Maybe you guys just start to push. Guess who's only over there? Only Lunara. You guys can probably kill her if it's just the two of you and if both of your ultis are up.
Now,
not only do you get a free kill, not only are minions pushing all the way to core, you will get more minions. Zul has unlimited minions at all the time, as long as there's enemy minions on the screen. And that gets pressure on their keep, which gives them something to do besides hammering your core right now. And it's a 34%. You guys might have been able to win there.
Now, from Red's perspective, I really dislike them going back. Lunara was going to clear those out by herself, and they would have had four people in a camp on the core at level 20 with two people dead. That's borderline win condition for red team right there. And with their core already at 30%, I'm going all in. If you would have been it would have been Asmodan, Li Ming, Anubarak, and Lili versus these two heroes at the core.
Easy.
I take that shot if I'm red team. Now it's easy. Yeah, now the shot's done.
I would have been really pissed at my Li Ming.
My asthma. Now, speaking of win conditions, when your KT is up,
what did they do? They left. What should you do? You should leave. Sorry, that was for red team.
Yeah. And now Anubarak and Lili should have left once his teammates did. If I am blue team, as soon as KT is up, I'm grouping at 5 and getting on the core. Lili won't be up yet, and they only need to do 34% damage. Blue team could win off of that pretty easily, I think. I don't think that will happen, because we have 5-6 minutes left in this game.
I wonder if a boss call comes right now.
Maybe. Boss on this map specifically is really overrated. That's what the call is. And you just guys gave him a free turn, and though you just lost a keep off that.
Yep. You, yeah, I mean, my first inclination there would have been the opposite.
And
my first inclination would have been to guard the turn.
Well, okay, now this is silly. So, Stitches starts the boss. Talk about not being on the same page. Red is going to end right here. But let's look
it's
at Trav.
Trope hit, right?
Yeah, dude.
That's part of why.
Not on Asmo.
Rated on this map.
Not on Asmo. But Lunara. Look, if you put this Bone Prism on Lunara with Greymane right here, oh my
she
god.
Can't leap. You know she took Leaping Strike already. You know she's crazy mobile. You need to pay attention to the people that you need to Bone Prism, and it was part of our discussion earlier about not doing things just to do them. Doing things and understanding exactly the kind of impact that what the thing that you're doing is going to have on the battlefield. And if you just have an inclination to Bone Prism those fat targets and try to get those people still, why didn't you take Backlash, man?
Right, well, and also, but it's the second time this game that I can remember where it happens, where he Bone Prismed him and then got in there and started attacking, and Asmo just lasered his face and drove him away. I mean,
right.
You actually lost this encounter because you guys were both at full health, and now look at you both.
Exactly.
So Asmo won that encounter, and
you
probably could have killed Lunara with a good Bone Prism.
You could have, no, 100% they could have. Absolutely. Because it's the leap combined with the movement speed,
yep.
Right? You know you have a crazy mobile target, lock it down and kill it.
Now, nope. if I'm red, this is the go for the throat moment. And you need to try to get out alive. Yeah, that's not a bad idea, Travi. Although now you've been spotted. Yeah.
Yeah. And now it's, yeah.
I may have done it up here, behind the boss, maybe.
Yeah, I would have just went straight up to the boss and did it.
Now, this is a bronze thing. Why is red pinging the boss? This game is over.
Just go win.
All you need to do is walk to the core and win. This boss call is completely superfluous. Everybody on red team needs to go straight to the core. And look at what they're doing. I don't even know what they're doing. Getting chests, I guess. And this is a very Bronze League thing, by the way, is not knowing when to end. Asmo's trying to solo the boss? No, he's actually just standing at the boss doing nothing.
He's been standing there that whole time. Now he starts it.
Because Asmo and Anubarak are going to solo the boss?
Yeah, it's about 15 minutes.
This game was 100% over. Red Team has already won this game. So if it turns out any other way, this is, well, 30 seconds ago was the moment they lost it.
Yeah, I mean, they would have lost it right there, right?
Yeah. Yeah, this, I would say, honestly, is the biggest... I've Lili got stunned out of that by the boss, oh my god. Honestly, is the 100... Well, the biggest difference between the lower leagues and the middle to higher leagues is knowing when to end. Now, granted, this boss is probably going to end, but this game could have been over 45 seconds ago.
But the thing is,
and they're not even
right?
pushing with it. They're not even pushing with it either.
And that's the thing, right? First of all, this boss has to go through a keep. Already unoptimized in terms of trying to win. Second of all, they were four dead. What is stopping five people from being on the core at level 22? Nothing. Nothing was stopping. Oriel was stopping you guys. Somebody who can't effectively do anything if she doesn't have somebody else with her.
So, this game is over. I don't think there's anything we need to say specifically about how the rest of this game goes. Let's talk about Travi specifically and things that we think he can take from this game. Number one, I would say, is prioritization of that Bone Prism target when you're Azul. And you can take that to other heroes is just who you're putting your cooldowns on, right? When you're Jaina, don't drop a Blizzard on Muradin. That's not high value. You want to be dropping it on somebody squishier or creating a zone. So for Azul specifically, really, really focus on who you're going to put that Bone Prism on. And I think you have a very unoptimal build. Basically, with all of these talents that you took, the only time you're getting value out of them is when you're using your Q. If you took all of those Wave Clear talents, you're getting clear every time, or getting value out of it every time you clear a minion. And since Zul's greatest strength is clearing minions, really make that even more. Because if you're taking Zul, you're taking Zul to clear minions. So let's make it even more effective. I really want to see a different build out of this in the future.
Yeah, I would say number one thing that you can learn from this game is the concept of value. There were literally times in that game where if you had decided to use a cooldown later, if you had decided to use your ability on a different target, things actually would have turned out differently for you guys in this game. I'm not going to put the whole game on track.
No, not even a little bit. And actually, if there's anybody in his game, I would say he was one of the few people that kept him in the game early while the rest of his team was running around like chickens with their heads cut off.
But it's still an important thing to understand because it's a team-based game.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to come down to any one person, unless somebody's throwing, like a Ragnaros. It's going to come down to your ability to set your team up and enable your team to carry through to victory, to make kills, to make plays, to, you know, change around entire engagements. Build is one of those things that's very important. Maybe it's just the style you learned how to play, and maybe it's just what you're comfortable with. But you have to experiment. You have to be able to be flexible on your talent choices, because otherwise, you're just gonna get stuck. I mean, we know that he's climbed, right?
Absolutely.
He's gotten some of these lessons probably along the way, maybe not from us specifically, but
it
will go a lot farther. It will continue to help you grow if you learn some of those lessons.
I go back to for basically one reason, and that's to clear lanes and put pressure on somebody. You're not taking him for his Q, so emphasize your strengths even more. I suppose there could be specific situations in which you would maybe go into a different build, but those are really niche. And Yuzul is a wave clear guy. Really accentuate his greatest strength, which is that wave clear.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, if you want more team fight out of him, that's fine. His team fight talents start at 13. Actually, they start at 10 with Poison Nova, but
Poison
they start at 13. Before 13 are only sustained talents. That's why a lot of people pick Jailers along with the Rathma's Blessing at 7. Because your Jailers spawn two extra skeletons.
Which heals you.
That don't count towards your maximum, and both of them heal you. So it's one of those things where that's value right there, right? That's understanding your kit, your hero, your ability to get things done, what you are and aren't going to be able to do at any given point. Yeah, stuff like that. Is this one an old one too?
I'm talking and I was muted. I'm going to start over. Yes, this is an older one, so it's going to take a minute to load. Travi, clearly by watching that, you're not a bronze player, a bronze 5 player. So I'm not surprised you climbed out of there. And I think Blackheart's Bay specifically is actually a really hard map to judge team dynamics on because it's such a chunky map. Cursed Hollow, on the other hand, is, I think, the easiest map to grade decision-making and within the team concept because it's a more of a traditional Quoty Fingers MOBA map. And
parallel, more or less, lanes, and the objective is super easy to understand.
So Andreas is our false dad this game. He is in lobby with us, so feel free to questions, feedback, whatever. It's always great when you're in lobby with us so you can interact with it. Both Mitchell and I play a ton of false dad, so we're pretty fluent on him. So we could give you hero-specific feedback as well. But let's talk about team comps. The traditional, easiest to execute team comp is a tank and off-tank, two damage dealers, and a healer. And your tank has that, or your team has that. Your main tank is ETC, your off-tank is Varian, your two damage dealers are Tychus and Falstad, and your healer is Malph. Perfect. The other team has more of a wonky comp with double support and an Asmo, which is kind of weird. They actually don't have an assassin on the team, which is a little bit odd. I would assume Lili will spec into damage. She can kind of do assassin level damage if she does it right. Nazebo does assassin level damage too, especially as his poison starts getting later in the game. So just keep in mind your role in this game is going to be the mobility factor and damage dealing on high priority targets. So what we don't want to see you is putting a bunch of damage on Muradin unless they're auto attacks. Gathering Storm is a perfectly great talent. I think Wingman is your other option. One, either one is fine.
10 seconds.
Yeah.
5, 4, 3,
might have chosen Wingman.
I probably would have too, but there's nothing wrong with the Gathering Storm. They're both
no,
great.
Not at all. It goes along with a discussion of understanding the other team's ability to mitigate damage as well as your team's ability to hand out damage. And both of those sides are a sustained versus burst, so that's a whole other discussion to get into.
So be aware when looking at the map, you generally don't want to face check bushes. This isn't as big of a deal because it's on your side and you beat them there. But you do know that Varian is not with you guys. So you could be a 5-on-4 here. That's something your team needs to be aware of. As Falstad, I know what you're going in there for is you want to throw as many Qs as possible and start building up those stacks. That's fantastic. Go to the middle lane, skirmish a little bit, throw some Qs out, and then fly to wherever you're going to go. That's fine. Also be aware when you either play Varian or you're with your Varian on the team, Varian is terrible before level 10. He's terrible. And so you just have to keep that in mind. Whenever Varian is in a game, take advantage of that if he's on the opposition, and be aware of that and work around it if he's on your own team, and hope whoever's playing him knows that as well.
A little tip I picked up from the pros, if you're taking that Q build on Falstad, is to fly into an aggressive position and get the Q out as people are coming out of the gate.
Mm-hmm. Hey, great on watchtowers, too.
Get like 2 or 3 stacks and mm-hmm. just leave. Just bounce. Just go to your lane that you want to be in.
See, don't fight mid is not the right thing. It's don't hard engage mid. You actually want that skirmish mid to build up your Q. You could get 2 or 3 easy stacks.
Yes.
But you were right that you don't want to hard engage without Varian mid. That is correct. A little skirmishing is okay, though, as long as everybody does it safely. That's perfectly fine. Like, you know, a good example of that is Sky Temple. Everybody fights over the top vision. When you're on Falstad, you fly straight to that vision, and the enemy always comes through the same bush corridor. You get the vision, you throw your Q in there. It's like 3 stacks 30 seconds into the game. It's easy to do.
All right. Number one thing I'm seeing off the bat, stutter stepping.
Yep. Get in the habit of doing it.
If you want to learn how, hit up Brian, get my battle tag, and we'll go over it for however long it takes you to get it.
Yeah, totally. Kyle Ferguson also has a great YouTube video on stutter stepping. It makes it really easy.
Falstad is one of those heroes that's got movement speed built in, so it literally makes his stutter stepping infinitely better than anybody else in the game because he can do it faster, he can get away faster. It's one of those discussions we constantly have about
another small
being
thing.
Being able to be mobile at any given point is really important.
Yeah, because
games, I mean, to avoid damage.
Skill shots are harder to hit on a moving target than a stationary one. So,
exactly.
Small thing here. They're going to eventually respond to your pressure, so you don't want them to catch you. You should be down here somewhere. Be as far away from where the rotation is coming as possible to still do what you're going to do. So that means you need to be down here somewhere, a little further away from where that rotation is going to come.
Yeah, I like that. If you're doing the same exact thing you're doing now on that bottom tower,
yep.
Same exact value.
Now back up, though. Perfect. Nice. Don't eat the tower shots.
A little bit safer because you can then retreat into bushes instead of mobile.
At this point, though, because you should, by the way, this whole time you would probably should be watching the minimap more than what you're actually doing. Once somebody goes missing from the other team here, be aware of that and adjust accordingly. You're in a really nice spot. I would even like to see you even a little further down toward this bush, firing at the minions at maximum range, just so you're in a safe position as possible as soon as somebody rotates away.
Yeah, once you get that initial Q out there on the wave.
And by the way, that's why. Because if you're out of the minion wave, that he could only hit you or the minion wave, not both.
Chromies, Asmodans, people who like to use abilities to wave clear if you're not standing in the wave, you won't be hit by
them. Make them choose one or the other. And by the way, that goes both ways. If there's a Nova on the team, you want to stand in the wave clear to block her snipes.
Right, I was about to say that.
Yeah, so just...
And, And actually, you even brought me to another point even further than that. If you were stutter stepping, you would have been out of the line faster than if you just did.
Nice Q stacks. There you go. That's really great. That's a great spot where you're in right now. And know your lane matchups. You're going to lose this. If they leave you one-on-one versus Asmo, you're going to lose the lane. And that's okay. You just need to kind of know that going in. So do your job, which is to soak the lane safely without dying and put yourself in a position to rotate to the tribute on time with full health and full mana. If you accomplish that, regardless of how much damage your wall takes, you've accomplished your job.
I would have gotten a little bit aggressive there. I'm an aggressive false stat player in general. Right. I would have gotten towards that bush down there, thrown my Q and my W on Asmodan as his minions were pushing into the wave. So maybe about 7 seconds earlier. If you get some pressure on him, you're at full health, you're at full mana. Getting his health down is actually really crucial.
And Andreas is 100% correct in his analysis here. This goes back to what I was just saying. Understand the laning phase is not about winning individual battles. It is about safely soaking experience. If you're put into a situation where you can win the lane battle, that's fantastic. Then go ahead and do it. But blue team has left Varian 100% unchecked. That means red team needs to know they're going to lose the mid lane, and that's okay. It is 100% unexcusable for ETC to die here.
You know, I agree with Codadius in the chat too, which is such a nitpicky thing, but down here, and you're doing it now, which is fine, but doing it even before, in, you know, both waves, in the wave previous and in this wave, I completely disagree. I don't think that Falstad loses a one-on-one with Asmodan for very long.
Well, let me rephrase that. If Asmo uses his D in lane like this one's doing, you're going to lose it.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, totally.
Yeah, because he's using his D in lane.
But Falstead does so much damage, he just puts really great pressure
now,
on.
Let's talk about this specific situation, okay? You guys are up about a half level. ETC has just died. Varian has not even started rotating yet. And you know the whole enemy team is closer. This is a conceded tribute.
This is where we start to have a discussion about thinking of other ways to do things.
Just stay in lane, soak it out, and it's the first tribute, it's so irrelevant.
Dude, I wasn't even thinking that. Check this out. Falstead flies to top with Varian, and they get a fort.
Yeah, that will work. That's one of those things that's hard to pull in solo queue, a Hero League now.
Of course. I mean, it's almost impossible.
Right.
But it's body language again, right? If you ping that you're gonna go to top, if you type in chat Varian stay top, you guys got free push and you guys might have actually gotten a forward out of it.
Yeah,
because he already had most of that wall down.
My move would have been in that situation simply give trib soak.
Yeah,
but let's look at where,
which isn't a bad move either.
Andre, look at where you are right now. And look at where your teammates are. You need to get out of here lickety-split. Like, lickety-split.
Keep playing it. Let's see what happens. Not to harp on these things too much because they're so situational, but yeah, you can see he just got value from his Q and then he went fully. I don't like the extra shield on the E at 4.
Nope. Hammer gains or static shield?
I consider it a trap talent.
I agree 100%.
Whenever you use your E, if you weren't going to get out, you weren't going to get out. But 99 out of 10 times, you get out with your E. That's your escape. That's how you know that you're already leaving. The shield is almost a non-factor, depending on how you play him, right? Depending on if you E over walls, if you E into a place full of minions, all this kind of stuff. But
now
the
also
reason that I consider it a trap talent is just because it's not as valuable as hammer gains or lightning shield.
Now, you actually did a nice job of getting value on your Q and leaving, so that actually wasn't badly played because you didn't stick around longer than you had to. However, Falstad's role, by the way, is to always go to the furthest lane after tribute. So even though you hearth back, let your team know you're going top. Don't make them run all the way up here. They could stay and do other things. So even though you hearth back, let them know you're on your way top. That way Varian doesn't go up here because that's your job when you're Falstad, right?
I also don't think we've seen a fly this entire game.
Nope, I don't think so either.
At the time of this replay, I'm sure the cooldown was still 45 seconds.
There it is. And see, you're doing the right thing, but communicate with your team so he doesn't waste his time going up there. He could have been helping mid already.
Not only do you communicate, but check this out at the same time. And this is something that took me a really long time to learn on false stats. You don't have to fly into exactly where you want to go into. It's almost unnecessary. And by the time you get into where you want to be, quote unquote, where you want to be, it could actually end up being a bad thing.
Yep.
So, yes, this is what I see pros do all the time is
they fly close.
Safe.
Yep, fly close and walk.
If you can get from the core to the back of any fort on this map, and it's in your range, and in that one, it gets you there sooner, it tells your team not to move that much sooner, and it puts you in a safe position away from any rotational gangs.
Now, this was all great. Everything I was doing here, great. I agree with you. At four, I 100% of the time take static shield or hammer gains. Static shield makes you such a good lane dueler.
Does.
And on maps where you're going to be auto attacking a lot, like this one on the buses, for example. Either one of those is always good.
Just because you're not going for the seasoned marksman build doesn't make hammer gains not valuable. Hammer gains is always valuable for false tech because he's got a pretty decent auto.
I know your positioning, so you just overstepped your tank and they're right into the whole enemy team.
He just absorbed the flying too.
There you go. Stay safely. And you know what? Varian and ETC are giving you a really nice front line here. Don't channel. You're never going to finish this. They're giving you a really nice front line. You should be right back in here, wailing on whoever you can get to safely. If you can only get to... Is that Brightwing they got? If that's Brightwing they got, you need to be putting this all on Brightwing. And it is.
Yeah, that's the thing. It doesn't matter who they got. It's somebody that needs to die because they got double stunned.
If they got Muradin, put your auto attacks on him. You don't need to waste your cooldowns on him. But they got Brightwing. Everything you have needs to be on this Brightwing right here, not channeling.
Everything. All my auto attacks. I mean, just,
and he would have died. He would have definitely died. Now remember, they have double healers, so you guys aren't going to win these protracted battles. You can see it in the health bars right here, actually.
This is part of that analysis that happens when you first get into a game. If you had taken the W talents here, you would have had extra range. You would have had a shield on there. Okay, it ends up going.
Even still, though, Brightwing should have already been dead.
Yeah, exactly. If you guys are one of those teams where if you don't get done what you need to do in the first 15 seconds, you guys are spent, and you guys need to take this lead.
And look, even with the double sustain, they're still outfighting you guys 5-4 almost.
That's the thing, right? Like, one of them had to leave, I think, the tap.
Variant.
Protracted battles don't happen when there's double support on the other side.
And Mouthfall, that is 100% right, Give. Nice job. Nice job backing up and giving it up. You guys put up a spirited fight. You got one kill out of it. I don't want to see you leave here, though. I actually wanted to see you stay. Look, there's experience missing here.
Depends on the cooldown of the...
Of the flight. Well, and the flight, too.
And the flight.
Okay, there you go. So actually, no experience missed. Well played. I take it back. That was perfect. Nicely done. Yeah, in that case, it was well done.
Okay, there you go. And so, okay, so that's where it changes how you engage that e-talent forward, right? Because in that kind of case, you get value from going in with your e as opposed to escaping with it. So if you're worried about taking damage and stuff like that, or if you're trying to chase somebody, you actually use your E to get in. And this is, by the way, only when you have that talent.
Correct.
Use your E to go in, get yourself a little bit of a shield, start getting more damage on somebody.
And this, kind of with if you should notice Tychus coming up here, you backed up, which is great. You want to make Azmo feel safe. And as soon as Tychus makes his move, that's your E in. The two of you jump him right away. That's your E for engage right here as soon as Tychus makes his move. No, now, in. Yeah, you should have seen that coming. That's something you have to see coming.
This is something we mess up constantly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And this is something you can't ever do in this solo queue environment.
It's pretty hard.
There's not that level of coordination when you're dealing with no comms.
Nice interrupt, good interrupt. Putting all your... By the way, stutter step. That poison damage is wrecking you.
Yeah, you could have been.
Your problem there is that you were too far from your Yeah.
Okay.
The problem there is he was too far from Malfurion for Malfurion to realize that he needed to be healed. Because he kind of came in a flank position and interrupted it, which is great. But once he interrupted it, he probably should have retreated back with his team.
Yeah, I mean, it goes along with that discussion of flying and super safe and then getting
healed. Right.
The 3 to 4 seconds it takes you to travel from where you end up to where you need to be is not going to be at the detriment of your team. Whereas flying into the wrong place immediately puts you guys at risk.
Your team is making this mistake a lot, which is channeling. When you channel, you're removing somebody from the fight. So, you know, there's a lot of... And it shouldn't be the tank. It shouldn't be the full health tank either.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It shouldn't be either. The amount of times I get put... pros say that too. Pros say put healer on the channel.
Right.
And I can see it sometimes, but I don't understand most of the time. It's another hero with CC. It's another hero with sustain for the rest of your team to keep up the fight away from the enemy. It's a whole discussion.
Yeah, I mean, it should. It basically. By the way, you need to give back up. This fight is lost. You guys have lost. Back up. It basically needs to be a backliner. But I think we can both agree it should never be the full tank health, full health ever. Tank ever.
Yeah, tank.
You know, Manco, you're right. That's what I said. He backed up, which was good, but as soon as Tychus went in, he needed to go into. I really don't like this engagement. Nice damage on the Brighton, though. Although you guys have 10, now you want to go in hard. That's not a... That wasn't a bad gust, except for the Tychus threw down the laser after the fact, which makes it a bad laser, not a bad gust. But even so, the laser will get value, zoning away the tribute.
I completely disagree, Brian. I completely disagree. That was a bad gust.
Let's look at it.
Your team has the disadvantage because they just killed someone. If somebody on your team had just died and you used gust, it would have been a perfect gust.
But let's see why he used it. Okay.
For the Muradin, I would imagine.
I would imagine because the Muradin's right there in the middle of all of them. And with him just popping Tranquility, yeah, probably a bad gust.
And I'm
going to
tell you why.
Yeah.
Level 15 Falstead, let me tell you why this is a bad gust. It's your get out of jail free card. Not your get out of jail card, your get out of jail free card. What the difference is the fact that, okay, Tranquility, that's a get out of jail card. It is really costly for him to use that. It puts him in a position where everybody wants to target him and everybody knows exactly what he's doing and they want to stop it. It's a very high target thing, whereas gust comes out, it's gone, it's over with, it's done. You have a Tychus on your team. Never get rid of that tank. Are you kidding me? You want that tank to be close to you so that he's ignoring Tychus so that Tychus can kill him. Never, ever get rid of that tank. Guess what happens?
The tank's gonna live here.
Your tanks can take care of themselves.
Now,
first of all, you don't need to save your tank.
No.
You need to save your ass, you need to save Malfurion, and you need to save Tychus. The reason it's a bad gust is because it puts your team at a disadvantage in this case. Whenever you use gust, you want it to make your team have an advantage, right?
Or get out of a disadvantage.
And that's still an advantage. That's taking the fight into your hands again because you guys now have that space.
And you're correct. Also, because Tranquility was popped, that makes it even worse. Now, I know he did it because his life was low and a Muradin was in his face. That was why he did it. A better thing to do would back up. Just walk behind over here. Yeah. Stay in Tranquility, walk behind. He has Varian, ETC, and Tychus all surrounding him.
You have the heal over time with Malph already on you. And the thing about the Malph's Tranquility is, and this is I'm responding to what he's saying in the chat right now, the thing about the Tranquility is it doesn't stop Malph from doing anything else that he needs to be doing. In terms of his abilities, it's not like cups where that's the only thing that he can do. He can still get heals out on you guys. He can still zone for you guys. He can still W people. It ends up going in your favor, right? And that's totally fine. But in another scenario, you bought the delay for the other team, and that's why it's a bad gust. that's specifically why I wanted to call that out, because you let people survive on the other team that have a chance of coming back and turning that fight back into the favor of blue team. So it's just one of those things.
Murden was in a really, like I know
I don't
you...
want you to think, I don't want you to think that I'm telling you like this was the worst gust NA and you should feel bad about
no,
it.
No, I had just... that. We know I had worst gust NA. That was me.
It's just something to put out there. It's just something to think about. It's coordination. It's solo league. It's solo queue. You don't have the ability to hear Malph say tranquility. You don't have the ability for Tychus to say I'm going to put down a laser. And it's fine. You did what you did. It ended up being fine. It's okay. It's just something to think about.
Two things real quick. The reason he did it was because he was low and he was worried about dying. You could have just moved to the other side of Malph and been fine. Murden would have been totally hosed. And this is not risky, and I will tell you why, is because of this. They're all off the map, and they were all off the map 10 seconds ago. If they are all off the map and both bosses are up, they're at the boss. Right, let's see. Right here. Asmo's the only one on the map. Where are they? They're at the boss. So unless you're going to go invade and take their boss, you simply trade bosses.
People are starting to do boss earlier on Curse of Tala. And I actually... Everybody's in agreement on this. If you play above a certain level, the bosses don't get that much value.
Nope.
The reason that people do them
is because you get two
and counter pressure.
Yep.
You literally give the other team something to do that's not.
See, Malph had it. Malph had it.
That's not attacking, all that kind of stuff. So, something to be aware of.
Yep. Perfect gank on the Asmo. That's great.
Yeah, that was amazing. I like getting boss in like 6 or 7.
Yeah,
minutes.
You do.
Honestly, it's not a hard thing to do because the other team will be expecting.
Now you need to fly down to defend boss. That's what I would do if I was you right here. Yep, perfect. Nice layout. Your team got Nazebo. You flow down to defend boss. Perfect. And by the way, nobody else needs to come help you. You can do that by yourself.
Or Tychus, it's never as fast to travel. Sorry, it's never as fast to go home and travel as it is to just travel. Just to like.
Yeah. See, like I said, you didn't need Tychus or Malph to go down there at all. And this is a 10-minute boss. It's not really that big a thing. I think a lot of teams tend to overreact to the bosses early in the game, to be honest with you.
And that's why I like getting them so early, because it creates this chaos on the other team that I don't even understand why you would get boss at that time in the first place, let alone the fact that you did and now they have to respond to it. Tribute.
But so far you've got the kind of traditional Falstad build, which is great. You've been pretty much on top of everything, nothing crazy. It was an unoptimized gust, not nearly as bad as mine that I killed Mitchell in.
Like I said, I don't want you to think that I'm harping on you for that gust. But
there you go, put on Nazebo. Perfect follow up from the tank. That's excellent. Excellent job.
Great job.
And that was good patience to wait for your tank to do his job and initiate for you.
And Nazebo's.
Get on Brightwing. Now get into, there you go, get into the Tranquility, nice job.
Aggressive gust.
Now, I like everything your team is doing right here, they're staying together, they're in pretty good formation. That's a great mosh pit, no, oh, you're running from the little Nazebo guys, okay, that's
yeah,
fine.
Yeah,
that's fine.
Those guys hurt.
Yeah, they hurt. Nice job, red team. Good job all around.
Another one of those areas where Lightning Shield or Hammer Gains would have been used.
Would have been better. I'm a big fan of Static Shield. I would say 75% of the time I take Static Shield and probably 25% Hammer Gains, but either one is fine. I think it's just a preference thing.
Yeah.
And you are correct, push is correct, but you also want to push multiple lanes because it's such easy soak. You want to have at least first tribute phase, at least 2 lanes worth of soak you want to get out of it. And if I'm you, Falstad, I stay right where you're at.
Wow, what is that Tychus?
I don't know. By the way, W would be perfect right here with your static shield. You could actually duel him. I mean, you can duel him now because you're up 2 levels, not with the monstrosity, but... There it was. There's the static shield difference right there.
There's the extra damage difference right there, too. I mean, the Q or the W build only increases your damage by 5% each time, but that makes a difference.
You know what? But even without the W build, the W shield talent is such a big deal.
Oh, he does get her. Okay, I was... Yeah, see, he's gonna go through there. He's gonna get his resistance. He literally can't tank for him because he's not... Okay, he... Oh, man. You love to see those bronzing players do stuff like that.
Who are you talking about? Varian?
Varian.
Yeah.
Going in on Lili for the reason of killing her. Yes, awesome. Guess what? He in as tribute, or as curse ending. Precisely when it was ending.
Absolutely.
And not been in that situation. He ended up fine. Obviously, it's okay. But what did I hear Grubby say today? When you're analyzing your own games, guess what? If I were the Varian there, I would have considered that a death.
Mm-hmm.
For myself.
It should have been.
To get better.
It should have been.
Because it's not that fate didn't want you to die at that moment. It's just that you had the right timing.
Nice job, guys.
9 times out of 10, you won't have that correct timing, and it will end up being more for you. That was stupid.
That was a really silly invasion. Brightwing and Muradin went in hard on a 3v2 with the tank, and the 3 was the right 3.
And then the Varian showed up, and it was just all over.
By the way, that was a good example of where not to fly. You should have flown back here. Save her the E. It's not that big a deal, but... There you go.
An excellent stun.
Yep. Nice job, guys. I mean, you've got the ho-hum Falstad build. It was fantastic. There's nothing wrong with that build. This is the build
we have the luxury of hindsight.
Yeah.
We have the luxury of knowing that this match lasts almost for another half an hour.
Which I was weird, because your team is doing so... Although, you know, this is actually a thing where it could be misleading. Even though it just feels like red team is winning harder than they are, structurally, both teams are dead even.
Yeah, that's the thing, right? They're not actually winning too hard. They're winning in levels, and they're winning in fights, and that's it. From playing any MOBA, regardless of which MOBA it is, it's all about structures. The objective of the game is to kill the core. You can't do that if you don't have structures down. That's why you're losing badly in the structure
now,
game.
Now, okay. For the record, I think you had the right call. And I think you're already leaving, but with Curse Point, you have to go back down here. I think you already are. Yeah, okay, perfect. Yep,
yeah,
nice. Nice, nice. That's the right decision. And you guys know this should be a free tribute, because look, their choice is abandon the boss or abandon the tribute. If I'm blue team, I abandon the tribute, because for your team, it doesn't matter. It's more important for theirs. I don't know what Brightwing is doing here. This is a terrible spot to be for Brightwing.
She's just buying time.
I guess. That was weird.
Oh, they end up getting it in.
Now, Varian has already... Look, he's here started, so now you guys need to respond. You can fly up there, Falstad. Get up there and help him.
He used his fly, but I don't think it's up.
Huh. And Varian actually did you guys a nice favor by starting this thing off and bringing it down to about half.
Super interested to see what they do with it.
Me too. My call here would be probably kill Asmo.
I grow tired of your petty squabbling.
Oh, never mind. I get Trib.
My favor.
You get Trib, then kill Asmo. Yeah, see, they can't even defend this Trib either. So, you can... Oh, they are. They are defending. Okay, ETC, by the way, should be out here. Right there. Because otherwise he can't catch them till they're here. If ETC were in this front bush, he could have stalled all of this out way earlier. Yep. Now you got a ping retro. Oh, nice mosh. I take it back. It's probably not enough, although Varian is here now. Although Cups is going to make this much more difficult. Cups is the most underrated ultimate in the game. No, don't vote. Oh, I think this is a mistake. Varian's going to die. You're probably not going to tribute it. I really think you either need to fight or leave, but not channel tribute mid-fight.
I'm going to throw something.
And there it is. That's why. Nice. There's a good gust. Oh, no. The poison damage. That was a good gust, though, if it saves ETC.
Something that I could have buffed in a shot called coordinated. In the counter push with the boss. I know that this is curse point.
Yep.
But the thing is, the main I guess kind of priority target in Asmo died from the rotational gank by Tychus and Malfurion. Right at the same time as the tribute spawned. Tychus and Malfurion actually didn't even want to contest the tribute.
Look at the ring around the rosy here.
Tell you and ETC one thing specifically. Go push with boss. You guys could have gotten a keep out of it, which is a lot more valuable at this point in the game than all of this fighting that's happening just back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. It ends up going in your favor, which is great.
Once again, don't channel with the thing wailing on you either.
Yeah, just kill.
That was a very interesting battle, and that was really foolish of Blue not to take the engagement, but the way they trickled in and they didn't wait for everybody. That was why they lost it, was the trickle engagement.
You can't solo bruisers unless you have
static shield. Static shield and wingman.
Static shield's not going to do it either, honestly.
No. Well, actually, with static shield, you can do the giants, though, but not the bruisers.
Yeah, you just need to be able to get rid of one or more of them instantaneously, which you can do with your bribe talent.
Let Malph out. Don't block Malph from leaving. Let Malph out.
Eat. It moves you past people.
Or just step to the left. Yeah, now, this is so important right here. 20 to 17, they have to fight it. You guys all need to get there on time and ready to go. This is such a big point in the game right here. I don't know what this is. I think Varian is going to cost his team the tribute.
You know, okay, I'm going to go... You're gonna call me crazy.
Unless he keeps them both down there.
No. That's not what I was going to say. You're going to call me crazy here.
I call you crazy anyway.
Yeah, I think he had the right idea.
Varian?
And I think the rest of... Yes, I think the rest of his team should have gone to kill those two people that are right there. And I'll tell you why. This may be curse point, right? First of all, you've got Falstad with a fight. You've got Malfurion, who's got pretty much infinite delay on one of these things, much like a Chromie or a Leeming. So this situation is thus. The Falstad, the Varian, the ETC, and the Tychus go down and get two amazingly valuable kills in Brightwing and Asmodan. So it puts it in one direction, right? If they get those kills, if Blue Team gets the curse, they still can't do a lot with it because they now have two people dead, two very important people to their team. If they do get the kills and Malfurion stays behind to delay, you now have two kills and pretty much a free tribute because you guys would have just rotated back on the tribute anyways as it was being delayed. This could have been the curse point that ended the game. We're going to see what happens here, obviously, and this is pure conjecture. Like I said, Brian, you could even call me crazy for even suggesting that.
No, here's what it is.
I think the Varian had the right idea there. Okay. And I think that the rest of the team should have backed him up.
Two comments. One, let's say Varian had the right idea. It's not the right idea if nobody else goes down there. Then it was the wrong idea.
Okay, fair enough.
But I think that is a really good example of the difference between solo hero league and coordinated play. In team league with all five on comms, oh, for sure you make that call 100% of the time. But in solo league, 20 to 17, I say keep it simple. Let's go take the 5-on-5 20 to 17 fight at curse point. If they don't all show up and they split push, we get a free trib out of it. In solo hero league, I like just go take the 5-on-5, keep it simple, everybody on the same page. In a coordinated environment, I really like your call.
Like, the reciprocal of what I said is honestly the fact that, like, Varian decided to go in the first place, right? Had Varian stayed, they could have waited for the rotation, used an ETC and EH to get that initial stun and get all the kills.
And now we have the opposite. Blue is not showing up to what is a favorable engagement once Varian died.
Right. So, I mean, it goes both ways. It definitely goes both ways.
Nice laser. And, great. This Tychus has had really nice lasers. This is the thing that with a Nazebo, they have so much poke with the blinds and stuff to get you off of that channeling. You really want to stay in the fight until you're 100% sure you can get that channeling.
It's just like anything.
Oh, no! Obviously, that was a miscommunication. And you know what? That happens when you have an ETC and a false stat not on comms. It's one of those things. It's one of those where you guys press the buttons at like almost the same time, and then you're like, oh my god, what happened? So it sucks in the moment, but it happens.
And I'll tell you one thing as well. Because we have the knowledge of the game that we've played so far, right? We always talk about learning. Teammates learn. You've already had, I think it's only the one, but you did have a Gust that went out at the same time that somebody else's ult team went out. If I'm that false dead player, I'm just waiting. I'm waiting until the absolute last second to make a Gust, because I don't know what anybody else is going to do. I don't have control over anybody else. And if Gust is such a powerful thing that it actually messes your team up just as much as it messes the other team, as we just saw.
This is actually a really good illustration of what you just talked about, but the opposite. Red doesn't have enough heroes to make this much out of this.
Exactly.
And Falstead, you need to be really careful because you don't have any. You only have Brightwing on Vision, which is a global character, so you need to make sure you stay out of sight. And you're not going to contest this because you can't do anything with it. So don't even go down here. Maybe on the fall on the Brightwing, maybe.
Wind tunnel. I think it's the trap talent at 20.
I agree most of the time. However, I've had specific situations where I've taken it because of things I've observed during game.
Your Varian just got vulnerable on Brightwing.
Absolutely.
Kept attacking the tower.
Yep. You were actually in an A primo number one position to, and I even said it as you were coming up. I thought you were going to do it. That was a great position to kill the Brightwing. Right, not far enough. Right here, look. You should have been on him right now. This is a map awareness thing. You have Varian coming in. Tychus is already there. This is a free kill.
And this is where Stutter Stepping comes in.
No, back the other way. And he runs right through you. You could have put a slow on him. You completely ignored him.
You wasted all of these resources, all of the mana, all of the cooldowns, all of your focus, all of your clicks. You wasted all your APM on something that's not even going to go down. What I would have liked to see there is you move towards the shroud that's right there below you right that second. Start to attack the Brightwing as you stutter step along with the Brightwing as she retreats, right? Once you do that, you don't waste any cooldowns or anything like that because you don't know where she's going to go and she's a very mobile hero. You see the Varian come
Silly
in,
Brightwing.
Get ready, you see that vulnerable QW done. She's dead.
EDC just said waste of a curse, like they did something wrong. When they lost three people as the curse came up, it was a wasted curse from get-go. They should have known that, so I don't know what that comment was. See, this is the only laser I don't like. You have four heroes at level 20 plus. You guys are going to burn that boss down fast. Now if he puts the laser down, that's fine.
Yeah, we had the same stuff, right? You always... any Tychuses out there, if there's people who want to get better at Tychus, the one thing I've learned about his laser is that you have to make people deal with it. It's never preemptive, and it's never something where you're just putting it out hoping that the other team isn't gonna want to deal with it. You actively make them deal with it. You actively put it in their face, and you actively make them either retreat or run into it, which if they run into it, they're probably gonna die.
If you take Wind Tunnel, it really makes Gust even more of an offensive talent. So we're going to talk about this. We're going to talk about this Gust right here. Boss is going down. First of all, maybe somebody comes save Varian. I'm looking at ETC, by the way, to go save Varian. Here's the gust I want to see is right here. You've got the laser that's up, right? They're burning down the laser. If you put them right into this corner.
Welcome to the death corner.
Yep. Then look at, you have Tychus right here. You have the laser right here. You still have ETC up with a mosh pit, and they're all lined up perfectly for him. The gust was right here.
This is actually, even because of his talent choices, this is a perfect opportunity for him to E kind of downwards towards mm-hmm. where the Nazebo is.
Yep, and put them right in the corner over here.
And then do the gust the opposite way.
I don't even think it's necessary, though, because I want to keep them next to the laser, right in this cove between the wall and the house.
It's not necessary at all, but it's another one of those things to do in order to...
See, now this gust was only defensive.
Right. Yeah, he's going to have plenty of kills there.
I mean, that would have been... You guys would have raked them right there. That Nazebo damage is just killing them, dude.
And that's part of the reason why I would have loved to see the E over, because it would have gotten the Nazebo mm-hmm. position, yep. which has been their problem from this game, is that poison damage from Nazebo has been a problem for them this game. And that's an advanced lesson. I don't think we need to cover.
But yeah, that gust right into that corner, that's a mosh pit, which was just wasted. That's a mosh pit. That's a laser. I mean, that's easy kills. The team wipage.
That's why I think that wind tunnel is such a trap talent at that level, because one of the things that you as a player have already conditioned yourself in the game is understanding for yourself whether you're going to use gust offensively or defensively. If you're already the person who has used it defensively, then your disengage becomes this really prolonged thing where your team doesn't understand if they can get a kill or not. It sometimes puts them out of position, and they get caught by Nazebo poison damage like they just did.
Yep.
Whereas if you're using it pretty much exclusively offensively, it's a great talent because it constantly pushes those people back into your team. Extra damage and range on your auto attacks are amazing. Cooldown time,
epic mount, it's really epic mount
on your mount is, I mean, it's just invaluable. Even now, once they nerfed.
Great focus there on the red team, man.
They nerfed globals across the board, and I still think that Epic Mount is the way to go at 20 for Fallen's Dead.
The only time on all of the big maps like this one, it's Epic Mount. It's almost always Epic Mount. The only time I've taken Wind Tunnel is like if I'm on a smaller map and there have been things that I've noticed that I could think take advantage of it, but I would say it's like 2% of the time for Wind Tunnel. It's almost never.
Go back 6 seconds, because this is something that kills me. Kills me, kills me, kills me, kills me, kills me. Every single time I see this, something like this happening. Like I said at the beginning of the game, it is never, ever faster to hearth and travel than it is to just travel. Do you see how much closer you, being the Falstead and the Varian, are to this Brightwing than the Tychus ever gets to the Brightwing? Because that could have been the difference between a kill right there. If Tychus had just mounted up and bounced and gotten along with this Varian right now, same as you, you don't need to defend here. You could just be with the chase right now.
You know what I really want to see right here? I want to see a fly in front of the Brightwing.
Yeah, I mean, but that Tychus was full health and full mana, and there was no reason for that. Stuff like that irks me because
it's inefficient.
Not only that, it makes the difference. Sometimes, like, okay, I didn't say... I'm, like, going off here, because, like, I didn't say anything about it at the beginning of the game, because guess what? At the beginning of the game, it doesn't matter. You guys are 25 minutes into the game. You're level 22. Right now is the time where it makes a difference. And seeing those opportunities just as they go by are really painful. Because, you know, I think that this game goes on for another 3 minutes. I think you guys probably lose. It seems to me like you guys are starting to lose this game. It's stuff like that where you need precious picks. You need those death times.
And by the way, I agree Malfurion is push with boss. Somebody said defend after. Look at how far the... Let's look at this. Okay, look at how far the lanes are. Other than bottom, so you're going to need to defend a bottom. But you don't need to send everybody back to defend bottom.
Austin with Wind Tunnel, you go back and defend.
Right. Now, obviously, you can't push with the boss now. You guys need to keep them off of Trip Point.
Right.
But now, right here, though, somebody needs to respond to this. Like, right now. There you go. And Varian came too. No, stay in there, though. Once Varian dives in, don't go back.
Yeah.
And by the way, once Varian came in, if you had Gust up, oh, man, I want to put him back here. I don't know. Is it up? Oh, yeah. Put him back here. Put him back here so where they're taking core damage when you get rid of the minions.
You have to remember, too, anytime you take the wind tunnel, just because you don't get the perfect angle doesn't make it bad Gust. Even if you had got that exact parallel and thrown them into the wall, that back wall back there, it still would be great.
Saying all that, that went perfectly. You guys got the tribute and two kills. My call, if I'm on red team, is I want to get bottom key right now.
Anything that's not defending.
Bottom keep. It's the weakest one. Oh no, you actually, I take it back. I don't think you guys can end because you're so far away via top, but bottom keep or boss in 3 seconds. There you go. That's a good call. But everyone needs to be on the same page. Yeah, you guys have 30 seconds.
More importantly than being on the same page.
But Mouth needs to not start it. Don't start it, Mouth. Just wait.
In time.
Now you can start it.
See what happens here, because the other team is so close. I want to see what they do. I always say
that's a good place for the vision on the.
Yeah, they're gonna get invaded on hard here.
But this is a 5-on-3. So the call for red team right here, if they take a 5-on-3, is to disengage the boss and kill them all. Just kill them all. Forget about the boss at this point, because if you kill them all, the game is over.
See what happens.
See, they're still on the boss. If
you
get off the boss and kill them
boss
all.
Is still
if you fight the boss while you're fighting them, it's not a 5-on-3 anymore. Now it's a 5-on-4 or a 5 versus the boss, right?
Yeah,
everybody should have gotten off
like,
of boss and killed them all.
The reason that we can have a contest like boss is because we have enough minions to kill the boss before it becomes an actual contest.
So look, even despite that, you guys killed two of them. If everybody would have come off, you guys would have wiped them all, got the tribute, and the boss, ended the game. Nope, now it's a 2-2, and Tychus is useless. And Malfurion said, how? Because you fought while the boss was aggroed on your whole team. That's how.
What you guys do as a unit is move south to the alcove where they're hearthing right now,
And Blue, by the way, this is silly too. Blue just needs to go end.
Leash. It's okay.
Yeah.
You guys are 25 minutes into a game. Let the boss leash, and you guys will kill it faster after you guys kill people than you did before you had killed all those people.
So this game is over. Red has just lost.
It's called the throw pit for a reason.
Yep.
It literally lost you guys the game. Not enough people paid attention to that.
We had
a moment last night where we were playing Team League and we almost lost a game because of it.
Here's the thing, though. I'm going to interrupt. In this game,
go ahead.
Boss was the correct call. And to fight them down there 5-on-3 was the correct call. It was just you can't do it with an aggro boss. And so many people overlooked that. You cannot fight with an aggroed boss. And this is an especially painful one. Did you see the team kill totals, by the way?
Yeah. I mean, red team had so many more kills than blue team.
29-14
is painful.
But now you know why, Andre. The reason you guys lost a 5-on-3 team fight is because the boss was wailing on everybody. And since we're talking about your Falstad, you specifically never got off the boss. You never used the Gust to help your team. You never put damage on any of those heroes. And that was the key difference in this game specifically, was that boss 110%.
Don't be
it wasn't just you, though. But it wasn't just you. It was your whole team. It was your whole team. The only reason I singled you out is because we're talking about you, right? How can you get better? That's one of the ways you get better.
You lost this months ago. Don't be sad about it. Get over it. But, I mean, it's one of those things where it always comes down to execution. Think about it this way, right? When you're fighting a player has cooldowns, a player has mana, a player has health. What do bosses have? Constant CC, constant damage, constant high damage, by the way, and the ability to withstand a tremendous amount of beating. If I were Falstad in that case, best to disengage, ping retreat as much as I possibly can, and start to travel away, giving my team my body language of get away from the freaking boss, guys. And that sometimes makes the difference.
Absolutely.
I don't know that it would have. Your team could have been bullheaded and bullworthy and said, Falstad didn't know what he was doing and kept attacking the boss. But at that point, it becomes about your team making mistakes instead of you having made the mistake.
And this is the difference between coordinated and hero. But the really correct way to do that, right? Like, if we were on comms with our guys, you in that situation specifically, everybody simply backs up. Let the other team on the boss, because it turns out the boss just attacks the closest person, right? So if they are the closest person, guess who the boss attacks? The other team. And you have a wind tunnel to keep them pinned in there with the boss wailing on them. If your whole team literally would have just walked backwards, let the team into the boss pit, and then gusted them right into the boss, they're all going to die. And you guys win the game. Now, that's hard to do in Hero League, though. That's like more of a coordinated thing. But regardless, don't fight on the boss.
And see, sometimes I disagree, because if you do enough to get yourself out of the situation, your team...
sometimes will follow.
May or may not. Who knows? It's a contest sometimes. All the time in there.
Yep.
But if they do follow, and the worst-case scenario is they steal boss, right? Okay. One step removed from that scenario is they kill boss, and then you guys steal the point from them. The important thing to remember as a Falstad about both of those boss points is that your gust will actually, even if it's inwards, even if it's towards the point, there is enough space for that character to not be on the point.
Yep.
And that's just, and maybe that's something you didn't know. That's something that I actually didn't know for the longest time either, because it's such an obvious thing. Like, why would I push them towards the point that they need to be on, because that's where we're going to be contesting. But it actually pushes them past the point.
And on a wind tunnel, that's one of the times it's going to come in handy. Yeah. With a regular gust, right? That's not the right gust. But with a wind tunnel gust,
it's perfect. That's exactly what you want to do there. Yep. You want to push them in the corner and keep them in the corner. So, yeah, just something to think about.
All right, guys. Well, happy Monday. I hope we ran a little bit later than like, but we're slowly cutting it down, Mitchell. We are slowly trimming the time down.
It was a little bit better this week.
It was. Happy Monday, all. I'm off to see Star Wars. Andre and who was our first one? Travi, I will send you guys the YouTube. Hope you found it useful and have a wonderful evening. Thanks for the co-piloting today, Mitch.
Yeah, no problem. Take care, everybody. Have a good night. And let me know how you enjoy Star Wars, because I think you're going to love it.
I will let you know later tonight or tomorrow.
Good.
All right, buddy.